I think I am live. What's up, family? This is Juan J coming at you for Real Talk commentary. I'm on my phone and on my computer at the same time. So if one go off, the other one will remain on one. So I'm looking at you from my phone and my computer. So look. With that said, I want to thank everybody for tuning in. It's been a challenge to try to go live because, again, I am out in this country. With that said, there may be a little delay. There may be a little, there will be a little delay. It's not as clear as I wanted to be. But I'm live. So with that said, let me bring in some music real quick. I want to bring in some music before I start talking. Because I think that we in some serious times, and I want to recite.
It's date night. Millions of people are going out and queues are up.
What Marvin Gaye said. As a matter of fact, I think I'm just going to have my man Marvin play in the background while I'm talking. I'm going to keep Marvin playing in the background. I know it's late. I want to hold the viewers hostage. What I want to deal with right now is this book, the Constitution, or the Bill of Rights. I want to deal with the topic for tonight. Freedom of religion, speech, and press. I think that of all the protests that's been going on today, all the venom, folks upset, folks are having the issue with freedom of speech, and I need to at least whip up the Constitution. I keep the Constitution with me everywhere I go. Everywhere I go. I would suggest that every black male, female, Asian, Latino, African get a copy of the Constitution. Most of us have stopped reading. for whatever reason. You know, we've gone through our elementary schools, we've gone through high school, middle school, college, and we've officially stopped reading. And now we're more emotional than the substance. So again, I'm gonna read to you the Bill of Rights, because at the end of the day, I think that as African, as Native African Americans or Americans, we just don't know the Bill of Rights. So what went down in DC today was the alt-rights, the Unite the Right, Black Lives Matter. Everybody was protesting, trying to make a scene. But at the end of the day, in the bigger scheme of things, I didn't have no problem with the alt-right. I didn't have no problem with white nationalists coming together, expressing their freedom of expression, protests. Because at the end of the day, for real, if we gotta be honest, read your Constitution. Read your Constitution. We are so emotional, especially the men. Now, I can see females being emotional, but the men are so emotional that we forget that this country was built on the penal codes. The First Amendment, the Second Amendment, the Third Amendment, the Fourth Amendment, the Fifth Amendment. I can guarantee you right now that most people don't even know what the First Amendment is. Or the Second Amendment. Or the Third Amendment. Or the Fourth. The only thing we're concerned about is this. It ain't right. Racism, white supremacy, white nationalism. This is our country. We built this country. I'm gonna read the First Amendment from this book right here. I carry this book everywhere with me. I carry the Constitution everywhere with me. But most of us don't know that. So I'm gonna read this. I'm gonna read the First Amendment to the Constitution, to the Bill of Rights. It says this: freedom of religion, speech, and the press, rights of assembly and petition. Let me say it again. The Bill of Rights, the First Amendments, were ratified December 15, 1791. Amendment 1. Freedom of religion, speech, and the press, rights of assembly and petition. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or the right of the people, peaceable assembly, and to petition the government for the redress of grievances. That's the First Amendment. I read the Second Amendment. Right to bear arms. A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. That's the Second Amendment. And read the Third Amendment. Housing of soldiers. No soldier shall in time of peace be quartered in any house without the consent of the owner, nor in the time of war, but in the manner to be prescribed by law. My last one I'm going to read is the Fourth Amendment, search and arrest warrants. The right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrant shall be issued but upon probable cause, supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the places to be searched and the person of things to be seized. Why is this important? I know it's crazy. Why is this important? Because again, we are too emotional. Look, let me say something. I personally want to hear, what's up, Will? What's up, Tom? What's up, Kathy? What's up, Mike? I personally wanted to hear what the alt-right had to say, because they're speaking for millions of white folks in this nation. Not just themselves. 70% of white women put Trump in the White House. The Electoral College put Trump in the White House. Middle America put Trump in the White House. And I want to hear what they have to say about how they feel. Last year in Charlottesville, their theme was this: you will not replace us. You, meaning black people, or people of color, will not replace them. That was the thing. We are so emotional that for whatever reason, we choose to be emotional and not listen to what folks are saying. They broke no law. They was within the Bill of Rights. Freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, let them speak. The problem with us is this. I know that connection is bad, man. I know. I may have to make this whole video over again. The problem with us is this. We are emotional and we react without facts. So again, I would encourage every viewer to get you a copy of the Constitution. Get a copy of it. Keep it with you. Because in the bigger scheme of things, you need to know what your rights are. I don't care about white male dominant culture and white folks coming to protest. I don't care about that. I want to hear what's on their mind. Because at the end of the day, we need to know what they're thinking about. We're so concerned about them protesting that we're not even thinking about. These are the same people who buy all the ammo, buy all the guns, and they are waiting. They are waiting to unleash on us. Okay? And while most preachers, most men in the black community are praying, P-R-A-Y-I-N-G, these folks are waiting to be P-R-E-Y-I-N-G. They're praying. They're waiting for the sign to go. While every other community is practicing group economics, self-reliance, we're the only ones who still codependent on every other community for our survival. I mean, if you ever seen the theory of Pavlov's dog, when the dog responds to a whistle or to a beep or to a chime, that's who we are. We become Pavlov's dogs. We become the mice in the experiment. You know how you see those mice in those experiments? Or the rat in a Skinner box where, you know what, you can get a rat or mice to do whatever when you deprive them of certain foods, certain water, or the basic needs. We've become those, we have become that Pavlov dog, that those rats and those experiments. It burdens me because we have sacrificed our whole history just to blend into the bigger society. And I posted earlier today, I said, at the end of the day, these white folks that came from out of town to protest are going back home. And these same ones that was protesting against these white folks will be the same ones that go support their business tomorrow. Think about that. And black folks, Asians, Latinos, it don't matter. We don't know if they're store owners, what business they have. All we know is this, they came to protest, right? But when they go back to their places of confinement, their homes, their houses, guess what? We will be supporting their businesses tomorrow. You know why? Because we don't have our own. We're still concerned with protests, but not black group economics. We're still concerned with protests, but not black self-reliance. We're still concerned with protests, but not black self-confidence. We're concerned with protests, but our women are unprotected and their children are unprotected. But we want to protest. I mean, I'm hearing guys talking about some, not my hood, not DC. You're not going to come here and be disrespectful. That's the same thing I did back in the day, back in the 80s, when it was Palmer Park, Allendale against Sheriff Rowe, Burnside against Barlow, you know, DC, Petworth against, you know, New Orleans. Who does? I mean, we still on that old ghetto street mentality. You know, 58th against Clay Terrence. Are you serious? I mean, think about it, people. We are, I'm 50. I don't know how old some of these folks are that's still on this my block, this my street. But we're applying the same mindset to the system of race, to the system of racism and white supremacy. You can't do that. This is why I've been reading this book. This book. Man, you gotta bear with me because I'm not used to using my computer. I'm used to using my phone. So left is right and right is left. Because we are so caught up into, can I be honest? Let me be honest. White male dominant culture has given Native African Americans a pass to be upset with white people or the present condition. And we are all in right now. Think about that. In my years on this earth, I've never seen Native African Americans in so much rage over the current president and white folks. And the only reason why we're at this place right now is because there's a battle between the northern white folks and southern white folks. Okay? And black folks again, or in the middle, or in the middle again. And the northern white folks, the Democrats, the liberals, have given black folks a pass to talk about other white folks. And we feel so liberated that we can't control ourselves. I've never seen the conversations about Trump, the Republicans, that I've seen in the last 2 years. And just mind you, before Trump ran for president, his television series, The Apprentice, was number one in viewers, not just here, but around the world. Everybody wanted to be Apprentice. He could do no wrong. He could say nothing wrong. Nothing. All the celebrities, athletes, entertainers wanted to be on The Apprentice. That Apprentice went around the world. Went around the world. And when he ran for president, let's be honest. Can we be honest? Matter of fact, I will bring anybody in. I can figure it out. I will bring you in and we can have a conversation. Because I don't want this to be just a monologue. Let's have a dialogue. Okay. If anybody wants to come in and I can figure out how to do it, I'll bring you in. I will split the screen with you. We can have this conversation. Okay? Because we need to know when we're being played. The Apprentice, Trump, and when he ran on that ticket as a Republican, he knocked out 13, 14 candidates because he was just so blunt, so forthright, so transparent. Everybody was digging Trump. But when white folks got mad, and realized they couldn't control him, couldn't reel him in. They turned on him. And they gave black people the green light to turn on him also. I am no Trump apologist. I'm an independent. Been independent since 1991.
I'm not a Democrat nor a Republican. I'm a truthist. Okay? And I sit back and watch black folks, Asians, Latinos, whites, being played. Ask you to choose a side. I'm not that. The side I'm on is the truth. Period. But regarding this protest today, this whole test, and what happened in DC with the alt-right and Black Lives Matter and Unite the Right. This is all show. Let me say something. Can we be honest for 1 second? Let's be honest. Okay, so we protested. We showed up. We outnumbered them. Now what? Now what? I don't see no Democrat or Republican talking about black group economics. I don't see not one Democrat or Republican talking about black self-reliance. I don't see not one Democrat or Republican talk about black self-respect. They all talk about multiculturalism or can we all just get along? But none of them have read the code, respect the code, talk about the code. I'm loyal to the ancestors. My family. And to my culture. Again, my definition of a man is this. I protect. I provide. I give instructions. And I protect my culture. If all you do is protect your family, provide for your loved ones and give instructions to your loved ones, and you don't protect your culture, you're not a man. You're just not a man. Every culture I've had the opportunity of examining, of researching, I've seen one common denominator among them all, the men. They protected their families. They provided for their families. They gave instructions to their families. And they protected their culture. Asians protect their culture. Latinos protect their culture. Russians protect their culture. Palestinians protect their culture. Jews, Israelis protect their culture. Indians protect their culture. Vietnamese protect their culture. The only people in the world who don't protect their culture is Native African Americans. Facts. So if your only definition is, I provide for my family, I protect my woman and my children, I give instructions to my woman and my children, and you don't protect your culture, you are not a man. I'm gonna hold my last thought because I don't want to say what I want to say. You're not a man. A man protects his culture, not just his family, not just provide for his family, not just give instructions to his family. He protects his culture. Let me say this. On last week, it was the 73rd anniversary of the bombs that was dropped on Japan, on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Okay? When white male dominant culture dropped the bombs on Japan, they did not know what those bombs would do to the rest of the world. It was the first time in the history of the world that atomic bombs was dropped on people. And they didn't care what effect it would have on the rest of the world. Their whole goal was to win. They dropped one bomb on Hiroshima. And then 3 days later, they dropped another bomb on Nagasaki. Not knowing what effect the bombs will have on the rest of the world. You know why? Because at the end of the day, they were trying to protect their culture. If they're not going to win the war, nobody's going to win the war. When you really tap into the psyche of our white brother, you got to respect them. You really have to respect them. Because it's not just about the education. It's not just about providing. It's not just about giving instructions. It's about winning. It's about winning with them. Winning. I watched a video about a month ago, and Putin was talking about a nuclear war. He's ready to go to war if he has to. But he made a very poignant statement. He said, "What would the world be like without Russia?" Meaning, he's ready to drop a bomb on anybody if he thought that Russia was going to lose. He cannot envision a world without Russia. Trump can't envision a world without white nationalism. And Native African Americans can't envision a world without peace, love, togetherness, because they're afraid to fight. Let's be honest. Can we be honest? Again, if you want to come in and I find a way how to bring you in, I'll bring you in. I'm just going to say, it's not about a monologue. Let's have a dialogue. All I know is this, in the biggest scheme of things. I'm not in denial about who I am, whose I am. I'm not in denial about the country that I live in. I'm not in denial about the history of this country. That's why, again, I'm trying to get used to this screen. I'm not in denial, because I think that this may be the most important book never read. The American Slave Code in Theory and Practice. The most important book that has not been read to our children and our children's children. Sometimes I get speechless because I am very passionate about my love for this country. I'm very passionate about my love for our people. And I'm very passionate about my love for just myself. I want to see change. And I see what's about to happen, and I mean, somebody has to warn us what's about to happen. Can I be honest? I haven't watched probably local television in about 2 or 3 years. I mean, if so, if I'm talking about this, like watch it every day. No, I don't watch that. I don't have cable. I don't listen to a lot of the radio person, but I'm current on what's going on. I'm current. And when you cut back on the distractions and you in that still quiet place, you begin to tap into the universe. Not propaganda, but the universe. And you begin to hear and see what's about to happen. I am 100% sure that a lot of brothers and sisters wish they could say what I'm saying. But they're too embedded into their jobs, to their families, or whatever the case may be. They can't say this because, you know, they risk losing. They risk losing their wealth, their health, their job, their status. So they're tuning in. They won't say nothing. They may even give me a thumbs up, a high five. But every man and woman must be fully persuaded in what they are called to do. And like I said, right now, this is my call. I mean, I don't run from it. I appreciate everyone who takes time out of their day to tune in and listen to me. Because you can be asleep, you can be eating or doing anything. But you're listening to my thoughts. And I do appreciate it. I don't take it for granted. But at the end of the day, I truly want the best for us. I do. If you see me in public, you know how I roll. You know that I'm passionate. When I partied, I partied. When I hung out, I hung out. When I drank, I drank. Well, no smoker. I don't smoke. But when I did what I did it with the passion. So I'm doing this with the passion. So family, today's protest was within the Bill of Rights. They had a right to be there. Read it again. freedom of religion, speech, and the press, the First Amendment. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or the press, or the right of the people peaceable to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. I ain't had no issue with that. My biggest issue is this. I pray and I fast and I hope and I want Native African Americans to come together and practice Black group economics, Black self-reliance, and Black self-respect. Period. That's what I want to see. If we're going to survive, not me, because I'm 50, and I'm talking about my children's children. If our children's children will have a future, we're going to have to make some sacrifices of the partying, the going out, the smoking, the drinking, and tell our children, the truth about this country. Period. People are surprised right now because we've been lying to them for years. Why was not this book mentioned in grade school? Why? Who made the decision not to share this book? And what happened to our ancestors? Why? Ooh. Somebody made a conscious decision not to tell Black people, white people, Asians, Latinos, what the Native African American experience was. And then we got like 5-6 generations of youngins out here who have no knowledge of the atrocities that was perpetrated on Black people. We are the survivors of the greatest Holocaust in the history of the world. I'll say this again. We are the survivors of the greatest Holocaust in the history of the world. And that would include your Bible. Facts. The Bible calls you to imagine. But we get pictures. We have pictures. And then we get cell phones. We are actually documenting still the atrocities. Okay? That's the difference between the Bible and the pictures. Again, I just want the family to know this. I don't want to bring you gloom and doom. But what I do want to remind you of is this. In the history of the world, from Adam to the 2018, there's no group of people in the world like us. Let me find out this band. They ain't gonna call me when I'm alive. Who does that? There's no group of people in the world like us. None. We are the survivors of the greatest Holocaust in the history. I'm talking about not just the Middle Passage. I'm talking about the penal laws, the penal code. The code said this, even if a master felt a particular kind, generous way toward his most faithful servant, his most faithful slave, that he could not override the penal code. And if he did, the master and the slave could be whipped with the same amount of lashes. I may not get into the pinnacle tonight, but I just want to talk to you. Because in the bigger scheme of things, in the bigger scheme of things, family, I'm in the north. I'm like 360 miles outside of New York. I'm 50 miles outside of maybe Baltimore. Hundreds of miles outside of Delaware. 150 miles outside of Philadelphia. But if I was saying this, well, I'm saying it right now, but if I was living in the South, the Bible Belt, man, I'd be targeted. I'd be targeted. Not just targeted. They may contrive, or put together some type of situation. When I be gone, they may take me out. I know of good people who are doing the same thing I'm doing, but they live down south. And they are under watch. They're being locked up. They're being ostracized. They're being targeted because they're in the South. And I understand why my folks in the South can't talk like this up north. I understand. I do. I understand. Because once they realize where you live, they're coming for you. They're coming for you. There he is right there. He one of them smart niggas. But up north, I'm on a whole different level of grace. Down south, you a target. No matter what your occupation is. And I'm real with this. But let me say this. To my southerners, and my northerners, and my easterners, and my westerners, and all who will see this video, whether in the nation or around the world, it doesn't make a difference. At the end of the day, we are exceptional. And you need to know that. That there's no group of people in the world like us. That we are the ancients when it comes down to the system of colonialism. That we are the survivors, that we are the children, that the survivors of chattel slavery, or the descendants of free men and women who became slaves. We are ancient. And no matter how much media, whether it's print, radio, or television that they throw at us to try to persuade the rest of the world that we are worthless, at the end of the day, we're not. It's not what others think about you. It's what you think about yourself. It's not what others